Hi Vishnu.
Hi guys, just waiting for Vishnu to come. Hello everyone. So there he is, finally. Vishnu, your camera is... Hi Vishnu na.
Hey Mukul, what's up dude?
Nothing much. So guys, this is Vishnu Vardhan, Olympian, discover and whatnot.
Dude, it should be the other way around. I should be hosting you. You hosting me.
No, I think you have much more experience to give the viewers, so it's better I host you.
What's up, man? How are things with you? How's the lockdown treating you?
Lockdown is very good. I'm having a lot of fun with mom and sisters. So far, missing tennis a bit, but yeah, it's all right. I think in the last 15 years, I've played enough tennis, so it's okay to have. I think this is
What's
the first time,
like?
First time in my life I haven't taken a flight in like a month and a half, or at least even in a month. I've stayed in
first
one
time
day.
in your life, or
yeah,
like in a long time, a very long time.
Maybe
okay.
first time since 2006 or 7, probably, that I haven't taken a train or a train or a flight in a month.
Yeah. I guess probably most of the tennis players, I guess, is the same. So you tell me, what this last 30 days, 31 days, you think it went by fast for you or went by really slow?
I think it went very fast. I think
yeah,
it went
me too, man.
Really
yeah,
fast
me too.
Because
yeah.
I kept myself busy with training, at least, because I was training, you know, 2.5-3 times a day with morning activation and then one endurance or running workout. Then I was training with my trainer in the night also. So mostly it did go quite fast. I didn't feel slow. And I'm sharing the room with my sister, so it's pretty fun. I have my own room, but I haven't really gone there. Normally staying in that room.
So what's your routine like?
So my routine is I wake up around 1 or 2 because I sleep late because my training session is late. So I do the endurance run, I break the fast, I break the intermittent fast and eat at 2:30. Then I do the run at 3:34. Then I do the night session at 9. So I finish at like 10:30, 11, then shower, everything. It takes like one...
Oh, by the time you get it done and everything.
By the time I'm calm. So good, let's start with the session. I have a few questions for you.
Okay, dude. Let's do it.
So, first, tell us your journey into tennis. How did you start, or how Jagadishan uncle put you into the sport? I know it, but for the viewers to know.
So I would finish my school by about 2:30 and be home. And I didn't really want to play with the kids in my apartment those days. And I was always pestering mom that, you know, I'm really getting bored. I'm getting bored. What do I do? And then that's when my mom and dad decided that, okay, let's, you know, put some activity for him. So they actually tried cricket, basketball. My mom even tried singing and dancing also.
Okay.
But it didn't really work. And one of my very close friends in my class was playing tennis. So that's how I just started tennis along with him.
Okay.
And in less than a year, he stopped playing tennis, and the first coach with whom I learned tennis in about 6-7 months of me playing, for some reason he told that I should, you know, I'm having some natural talent. I don't know what he saw, but he said that, you know, he seems to be pretty talented, and he's like, you should put him to a better coach. And it was very tough to get admission to Nagaraj sir at that time.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
he actually put in a word.
It, no, admission. Doesn't call it.
Yeah, exactly. Like, admission is very difficult. So he actually put in a word for Nagaraj sir. And then me and my dad, we went and met him. And this is when he was setting up his new tennis academy in other side, in somewhere near Mudford. So this is long time back. So he was setting, I still remember, I was setting up this academy. And so he was also working manually. And we haven't, me and my dad never saw, like, who, we don't even know who Nagaraj sir is. So, and we just reached the tennis place, and then, you know, we see this guy working. So my dad just walks up to him and he's like, you know, I want to meet Nagaraj. Where is Nagaraj? And he was actually Nagaraj, sir. So very interesting. But thanks for that reference from my first coach with whom I was under about 5-6 months. So I got admission with Nagaraj, sir, and that's how it all started for me.
Okay, nice. So we are heading to the first serious question actually of the day.
Ah.
So we know that Nagaraj sir is all about basics, right? There's nothing been special. It was more about the very basic drills, playing half court, running 6 rounds. But from there, you were able to outtake many guys who are actually doing professional training and made it to such great heights in the sport. You played close with Nishikori, you made it to the Davis Cup team, you made it to the Olympics. So what is the one thing you think that worked out in your favor in those early days? What made that foundation and that serve with such less resources? And you know, the courts were really, really not so good. It was not any red clay, super slow clay court or indoor stadium. And, you know, fitness also was just the very basic stuff, what probably they do for the basic kids. But
right,
still, you've been able to make it to the highest level of the sport without any special talent also. So what do you think are the few things that really made the click and worked in your favor?
I think it was, I mean, for me, what really worked was just pure hard work, I guess.
Exactly.
I
yeah,
mean,
I remember.
Yeah, so that was one of the things which actually, yeah, which is like just pure hard work. And I still remember this quote that sir would always tell me that hard work will never go waste. You know, there were so many times that I would tell him that, is it really to do this? You know, I would go and tell him, is it really to do necessary to do 40 sprints? You know, why should we do 40 sprints for speed? It's not necessary. And he's like, no, go do. And then he's like, hard work will never go waste. And I would spend about 6-8 hours every day on the tennis courts. You know,
yeah.
I wouldn't come back home in the afternoon. So I think just pure hard work. Obviously, times have changed. Now you've got to be a little bit more smarter the way you work and everything.
Oh, of course.
But
all that
yeah, so, and I think that's one of the main reasons. I think after that would be the intention or the vision, you know, just having that intention that this is what I want to do. I still remember that I turned 16, it was 18 first year for me, and we decided that we'll not play any juniors, we'll just play all the national ranking tournaments in India. And I wouldn't even make it to the second, third round of a normal national ranking tournament. But whenever I would train at you know, with sir, the intention was that, yeah, you know, in few years, you are going to play Davis Cup. You know, you are going to play for India. And I would literally laugh at him. I was like, I'm not winning two matches with these guys. And, you know, how are you even thinking that I'm going
yeah.
to play that? He's like, no, just believe and it will happen. You know, just keep working hard and believe that it will happen. So the intention was there. And there was a lot of hard work involved. Apart from that, I felt that the foundation was good in terms of fitness, that a base was set, you know,
yeah,
a minimum standards for
push-ups,
yeah, the basic, yeah, like everything we wouldn't do like our today's speed training, yeah, tomorrow's endurance, we wouldn't do that. Yeah, for endurance sometimes we would go for a long run, but we would do everything on a daily basis, even
yeah,
the 6 rounds, yeah, a little bit of everything. So a base was there, and Nagaraj sir is really good with the technique. So
yes.
So that actually helped me out a lot in the beginning. So yeah, I think
especially on your serve and backhand, isn't it? Because it's
exactly yeah. He's very good with serves. So almost all his students have really good technique with serve, and they're able to maximize their potential with serve. So he's really good with that. Even now, I see some juniors in the academy that they are having really good serves, natural power with it. So that's something that he's special in.
Good, great. So great answer. Second question would be, I personally remember I came so many 7 a.m. mornings. My dad used to bring me just to watch you train, just so that I can watch and learn. And I used to just see you doing those drills in the fog, and you know,
yeah.
See only that shadow of the person doing the drills. And what gave you that motivation when nobody else could do it? You know, what made you come out there and do it at such a young age, to have the drive and to not look left and right at the other kids your age? Was it the upbringing in your family itself was like that? Because I think uncle is quite strict even that way. I don't think there's one house party every Saturday even back then.
There's still no house parties though, but yeah, I mean, thanks to Sonia, some things have changed at home, but yeah, the thing is, I think it's also because of the upbringing. Both my parents are very, very hardworking.
Yeah,
my mom was, we never had any housemaids growing up. My mom was working a job, and you know, she would take care of the house completely. My dad was always out working constantly and then helping me out with my tennis. So I've seen them work really hard. So it was ingrained in me that hard work is a prerequisite if you want to be successful. Yeah, hard work is the thing. And after that, I was a very fat kid when I was young. So I always felt that I have to do something.
Yeah, when I see the pictures, it's true.
Yeah, I was a fat kid, fatter than you actually. Okay.
So I don't think anybody has been fat in the tennis circuit.
I've been a fat kid growing up, and so I always felt that I need to catch up. I need to work really hard to get better. So yeah, so that, I think these are the two reasons that made sure that I'm doing something extra all the time. And the other, I wanted to make sure.
We had only house party and not party. I saw busy.
That is so true.
I think he wins the chat interview by far. I think we both don't stand a chance now.
Yeah, that's so true. We have house party. Even now we have a house party.
We have party, everything.
So I always wanted to be the first one, you know, getting into the tennis courts in the morning. I had this connection with this marker. His name is Gopal.
Yeah.
So he's my AM guy, and so I made sure that I'm the first one there and training and everything. So yeah.
Okay. Nice and very interesting chat so far. So let's come to your later part of life. We both have made friends for life in tennis, right? Even you and me, for example, I don't think we would have met in life if not we played the sport. I wouldn't have had any friends. Of course, maybe college or school if we went the different directions in life. But I think RRC has given you some memories for life, some real friends that you can count on. So tell me about your relationship with them when you were 15, 16, 17, where there was a bunch of guys who knew nothing other than tennis and had no responsibility but only had great fun training. So how was
so
it?
So I'm actually very, very close to the assistant coaches at Sir's Academy, at the School of Power Tennis Academy. So there are these three guys, Sageraj, Gopal and Ramkrishna, who work at the academy. And I mean, these guys, I think Sage is the only guy who completed 10th. The other two, I think they flunked in 10th, and you know, they've been with the academy since they were about 14, 15. The only thing they know is just some basics about tennis.
Yeah.
But they made sure that they instilled so much of discipline in me, and I would spend about 6 to 8 hours at the academy along with them. These guys normally, they come from a normal, you know, very small background, but they made sure that there's a lot of discipline with me, and I'm working hard and making sure that, you know, everything that I'm doing on the court is right. Obviously, sir was always, he was there around for us, but he was not always there with us. You know, he had the entire academy to take care.
Yeah.
So, and these people have a big influence on me when I was 14, 15.
Yeah.
So that made a huge difference. Apart from that, players like Saket, PC, Suresh, Praveen, they all are friends for a lifetime. And I still remember, I don't know if you remember, but I still remember, you know, you were this young, chubby little kid who would come to RRC in the mornings. And I still remember, you were 6 or 8, between one of these age groups.
6 or 7.
Yeah, 6 or 7. And sir has this habit, you know, whenever some new kid comes, he'll call this, 15, 16 year old kid in the academy and, like, you know, teach him how to do sprints. So it was my turn with you, and I still remember, holding your hand and running a sprint with you. I was actually only walking, and you had to run
And I was
beside me.
trying to keep up with your walking speed.
And I still remember this after the match in Guwahati where you beat me, So I finished that match and I felt I played really well, especially second and third set. I thought I played really well, but you were so good on that day, and you were very resilient mentally. That was the first time I felt that, there was a difference in the way you played. And I finished that match and I was like, I can't believe, this kid who was so small now is beaten me. So the long way, and tennis has given me so much. I mean, for me, all my friends, my wife is from tennis,
Exactly. Given
all the
us
mentors, everything. So yeah, so tennis has given me a lot.
definitely great. It's very emotional match, and I think in Guwahati it was one of the hardest mental battles that I have fought in my life, and I don't think I have been in such a mental state after that. I made a final of a challenger, and I think I will go even higher, but I don't think something can be that tough mentally, because I feel that, every time I play you, I always see you as that idol figure, and I just cannot get over that friendliness to overcome and try and beat you. And I spoke to Rafa's trainer, and it apparently very surprisingly happened to him the first time he played Carlos Moya, because when Moya asked him, why weren't you competing like you always did, you and Moya beat him 2-2, but he knew that Rafa wouldn't lose to him 2-2 had he played at his best. And he said, I just can't beat you. I just can't try and fight and beat you. And then Carlos had to convince him that this is not how tennis works, and on court we are not friends and everything. And then apparently Moya never beat him, but that's probably a mistake Moya made. But once after that conversation, Rafa always smoked him. But yeah, it's happened. He's the mentally strongest athlete in the world, so that's pretty much what I also faced all the times I played you. But yeah, Guwahati was a mentally a very tough battle, more than the tennis.
I agree. I agree.
So fantastic. Moving on. I think your life has not been a steady rise, right? It's been so many highs and lows, like that until like 15, 16, RRC was your world. Suddenly you won a national, suddenly you made the Commonwealth team, you went to IMG. And did you ever feel in your life that you could maintain the same discipline, or you were getting distracted? Was the expectations getting too heavy on you? Could you stay on track, or how was that experience to suddenly come out in the media because you didn't show any steady rise, right? It was not like slowly, okay, I go futures now, then challenges now. Everything in that 2-3 years happened so quick, and suddenly, how was that phase for you with the expectations and pressure and the new stardom that you found?
So I felt that things would change a lot for me, especially after winning the nationals. I got a wild card into the Chennai Open, and then I played a very short match, and I was smoked by Aslin in about 30-40 minutes, Chennai Open. So that was my first big experience of playing that, and thanks to winning nationals, I got a chance to play the Commonwealth Games. And that was the first international exposure where I got to see pros training, and we went to train at Bollitree's during December. So it was a good time to train because all the pros are coming training over there. And again, I would be at the tennis courts
Sorry,
from
Vishnu
5 a.m.
Kitana was just saying hello to both of us. Hi,
Oh,
Gonzalo.
hi. Hi, Gonzalo.
Thanks
That's
for being here,
nice of
Master.
him. So that was my first exposure abroad training, and then I got a chance to see all the top pros train over there because it was December, and I would spend the entire day at the tennis courts watching them train, making a lot of notes on what they're doing, what they're not doing. And so after that, in 2009 is when I made some progress on the ITF circuit, got into the 400 of ranking in just about a year from 900. And I actually I didn't really get distracted, but I thought that, you know, I always felt that, you know, once I make it into this rankings, you know, once I win the nationals or once I get into the top five in the country, then it, things would change. There would be I would have like a better I would be able to have a better support system. I could play a full schedule of tournaments, which was the main thing that I wanted to do at that time. I was very hungry to play tournament, but I really couldn't do that, and I was always ending up playing only about 15, 17 tournaments a year. It was not possible to do more than that, and I still wanted to train some abroad. So that was the only drawback. So that was only the frustrating part for me. And 2011, 12 was the only 2 years where I played a full schedule of tournament, and I got injured doing that because I didn't do it in the right way. So these are the things that I learned being.
That was going to ask you next, you know, because I think
Yeah.
that phase your marriage happened, which is a massive change in somebody's life. And I think after the marriage you were absconding for a few months, and you know you were doubtful whether to come back or not come back. And then I think in 2007 you were just hanging around in futures, and then in 2017 18 you tried to make it professional into doubles. So first question, how did marriage and parenthood change your life in tennis? How was it? Did you think it was a positive? Of course it was a positive decision for anybody, but you think the timing was correct, or how do you view it if you could go back in life and introspect?
So I mean I've known Sonia since 2009-10. So we've known each other for a while, and so and I was injured in 2012 because I played a full schedule of tournaments. I had decent support that year, but I didn't really plan out well in terms of how my body is coping up with matches and everything. So that resulted into an injury, and it took almost a year to figure out how to get out of that injury. So I was just not recovering from that injury. I didn't give myself enough time to recover. I was forcing myself to play into tournaments because I was ranked number two in the country at that time and doing well. So I didn't want to take too much break. And it was a good time to get married also. At that time, 2013 is when I got married. I was off the circuit. But for me, the marriage didn't really make much of a difference in terms of the goals I had in mind, because I felt Sonia was very understanding because she was
Of
having a
course,
tennis
she's been a
background, and
top
then
athlete herself, isn't it?
so she understood. And then it's not that it was an arranged marriage that, yeah, today I'm leading a single life and then suddenly I'm with someone, you know. So I've been with her for a while, so I've known her for a while. She also knew the kind of person I am, how much commitment I give towards tennis and things like that. So marriage didn't really make much of a difference for me in terms of what, you know, my goals are into career. Rather, it was so much more easier for me to travel because Sonia started traveling with me for my tournaments once I recovered. And after my injury, I had to travel to all, I mean, places like Bhilai, Raipur, and other small towns. We even went to Mandya and all to
I think
play
that's right.
tournaments. Yeah,
That
so we played, and then she was there helping me out in whatever way it's possible emotionally, you know, to be there. And so it didn't really make a much of a difference in terms of marriage. But yeah, and then after that, the decision to play doubles was very natural. You know, I was trying both singles and doubles. Me and Bala told each other that, you know, let us try to play tournaments together, and then we'll see how our ranking goes. And we were both, I mean, I was stuck in about 500 in singles, Bala was in about 300 in singles, and we both immediately moved to 120 in doubles. So we immediately scheduled to play some challenges and moved into top 100 very soon. So doubles was like an automatic decision that we had to do at that time.
Quite
But
natural.
the yeah, it was quite natural to make a decision at that time. But made a huge difference for me mentally. I mean, it's for sure the best thing that has happened to me, and especially this lockdown. I mean, this 1 month went really fast for me, spending time with my kid. 2018 is the best year for me, and especially the week where my kid was born on the same week where I broke into the top 100 in doubles. I was just sitting home and there
Oh,
were a few
wow.
other guys. Yeah, I was always 100, 101, 100, 101. And I was just home and there were a few guys who actually dropped out of 100 and I just moved to 99. That was the same week where my kid was born. So it was a great week for me, getting into the top 100, being home. And I mean, that year was great. Played Wimbledon with Bala, had my family over there to watch me play, to see me win a match. So that was really nice. But after that, I was always been struggling in terms of balance between playing tournaments. And I mean, we've had a lot of conversations, you know, about this on tour.
Whatever you're talking
Yeah.
right now, I've heard it 200 times in my life. It's more
Yeah,
funny
so.
than funny. I'm actually
So
bored with
we've.
the conversation because I know every word. I just know every dialogue by now.
Yeah, so we've had so much of conversation that what is the right balance, you know? I do, like, I play five tournaments in a row, then I'm missing my kid, you know.
Yeah,
I'm
yeah, yeah.
he's
I
having
know,
he's
but
speaking
right
few
now you
words
are
and
having such a tough time. You know, you're saying my son is coming in my dreams. I'm like, Vishnu, I don't know much about it.
so yeah, it's always been a struggle for me to find that balance, but I guess, I mean, I don't think anyone can ever be ready for parenthood. That is something that, you know,
Something
how
that
much ever
happens
you're
naturally,
prepared,
you know,
yeah,
you can
something that
never
happens. I mean,
ever be
exactly,
exactly.
even though I read few books about it, but then I think every person is very different on the way he deals with
Yeah.
it. Even though I read few books, they were like, you know, this is the right way to go about it. This is the perfect way to have a balance between parenthood and your professional career. But if that balance doesn't work with me, if I'm uncomfortable with it, then it's uncomfortable for me, you know.
Okay.
So that's about it for me, and I'm still trying to figure a way out to balance that thing. But now my kid has grown a little bigger, you know.
Yeah.
It's he's more he's not that self sufficient, but you know, there's a routine set for him and everything. He doesn't miss his parents as much as he would earlier, I think, you know. So it's a little bit
Yeah.
more easier now with the kid, yeah.
Vishnu, we have a question, although I have two more questions for you to end the day and then you can ask me a few questions. But we have it
Yeah.
from a tennis parent. He has asked
Sure.
about what prompted you to set Tennis Hub and why did you sell it? The journey with that.
So, Tennis Hub, this was the year in 2013.
Yeah.
That I was injured. I was sitting home, and
No, on the spot.
it was just yeah. It was just I just wanted to do something, and my dad is into business, so I think I have that thing in me to do something, you know, for myself. And you know, whenever I would travel to the US or Europe, most of us we buy a lot of stuff from Tennis Point or Tennis Warehouse, you know. So I
Yeah.
thought, you know, it'll be a great idea to have something like that in India. And we just wanted to give it a try to see how it goes, and spent very little money to set up a website. And it was I just did everything through my dad's office, and I found a very good friend in my partner. At that time, he was just a partner for me, but now he's a very close friend. His name is Afroz, who was handling the operations. I just helped him out a few months to set it up, and then in terms of contacts, I just used my contacts in the tennis world to get things started. But
Yeah.
he was handling it and is doing great. I mean, even now we are the number one as a retailer in tennis. But in between, as any businesses, you know, we've made some bad decisions, and we always, from the beginning, we made sure that we will keep the businesses or the company's interest ahead of our personal interest. So that is something that I believed in, and even my partner also believed that, you know, that is a way forward for the company to go. So because of that reason and because of some bad decisions that we made, we had to sell, you know, a major part of our businesses so that the company is, you know, still running.
Yeah.
But I've learned a lot, you know, setting up the business, and I'm still associated with someone who's founded India's best tennis store. So I'm very happy about the journey that I'm having through Tennis Up. So that's about it.
Great, great. I think Tennis Hub has helped me a lot, you know, trying to deliver strings on time and all those emergency stuff. I remember in Chandigarh, I literally made an order on a on a Sunday, and on Tuesday I had the strings in the tournament. So, you know, I think with, at least for me, it's been a very timely help many times. So, fantastic. The last two questions for you, Vishnu. There was a time when well, I've known you as a person now for like 12, 13 years. And there was a time where you were any other, you know, 24, 25-year-old player mentally getting frustrated on court with bad line calls, eating not that clean, or talking quite not immature, I would say. Obviously, you were very mature compared to many other guys in your age, thanks to tennis. But there was a time when suddenly you made a click, and it was like meeting a monk, you know, it was like meeting a learned, wise man who is emotionally so balanced from the inside, who knows, it feels like every word that you're talking, you know, compress the paragraph into one sentence, and suddenly your answers became very short and very informative at the same time. You suddenly started reading books. You suddenly became so disciplined in the room. You know, at this time I'll eat, and this time, and you were just so calm. I saw a sense of calmness suddenly when people, even when the umpires made the worst of calls, outside people tried to talk shit, and you didn't get into those arguments. You used to just sit calmly in a dinner table, which is a change I noticed suddenly. So, what pushed you towards it, or what gave you that enlightenment a little bit? What took you out from a young adult to a learned, you know, matured man? That change, I think. You know, I remember seeing that change.
I think, you know, I would give that answer what Pratik had given. Marriage does that to you, you know. No, but
it makes you say sorry without any reason and not get into arguments, huh? Because you know.
No, but I guess that was a time where a lot. Actually, it's a lot of truth in that. You know, funny answer, but yeah. I mean, I started from living at my parents' house to you know, to start a family of my own, to be more independent, to take more responsibility for myself. Now I know that, you know, I'm starting a life, a new phase of my life of my own. So I think those kinds of things added a lot of maturity in the way I was looking at things. And now after the kid, I'm looking at things even more differently. So I think marriage did... Sonia doesn't agree though.
I'm kind of surprised, because I personally think marriage makes men lose their nuts in the head. They just start talking absolute shit, especially when they start having kids. You know, I don't agree, because my dad has been married for 25 years now and I don't see him calm at all. So,
I think it's just about the way you will channelize that energy. There is obviously some energy, let it be for different people, the way they react to things. I think the way you channelize it. And apart from that, it was that time when I started.
Don't wait till you get married.
No, but that was the same time when I started doing a lot of meditations also. So obviously that is one of the main reasons. So it doesn't really matter what kind of meditation form you're doing. And I also started seeing the mental aspect of the game. Up until then, I never really thought that the mental aspect would make a big difference in your tennis career. So, I started, you know, exploring a lot into the mental aspect. I mean, even the meditations that I started doing at that time was mainly so that I can get better onto the tennis court. But only then, only after doing a lot of meditation, I realized that, you know, life is so much more bigger than just the tennis court. Until then, tennis court was my entire life. So that change in perspective made a lot of changes. And so it's a combined thing of everything that, you know, I got married, you know, setting up my own life, and then I got into meditation, and then I was exploring the mental part of the game. So all these things... did make a difference for me at that time.
Super. So you're saying marriage played a big part in you getting that Jnanodayam. Is that correct?
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. A huge part.
But did Sonia help you for it, or you got it by yourself?
அடி வாங்க போறேன்டா சோனியா ஆப்வியஸ்லி ஹெல்ப் மீ அ லாட் டு ஹாவ் த இன்னர் ரெவல்யூஷன்ஸ்
Help you a lot by arguing for the most in
Yeah.
those moments. Like, what are you talking about, Sonia?
No argument, only serpadi only.
Somebody from the IDD asking, can you both share the best funny memory you have with each other? What's the funniest memory you have with me?
Funniest. I think you know this conversation would be the most funniest memory of us, what we are having right now. You know,
Yeah,
speaking
actually,
live.
yeah.
Apart from that, I
I
don't
think
know.
for me,
Like.
when you down those three beers and you were misbehaving with the supermarket cashier in Korea.
I don't remember, man. It was, I thought it was non-alcoholic beer, you know. I was so dehydrated. I didn't know it was alcoholic beer, you know.
You were like holding the Magnum ice cream in front of him. Do you know why this is packaged so well? Because it's Magnum.
Oh, God.
Sonia is saying self-realization. All right, so a small rapid fire for you, Vishnu.
Oh, cool. Go ahead.
So it's going to be around 10 questions.
Okay.
You ready?
10 questions. Okay, all right, let's do it.
Yeah. The best doubles partner you have had till date to have fun on court.
Sriram Balaji.
One dish you miss a lot being in the current diet.
Biryani.
One big surprise that Mukund has given you that you never thought Mukund would do or is, you never imagined 7-8 years back.
Oh, seven, why 7-8 years back? I never imagined that you will be in this mental state that you are in even like 3-4 years back. That's a huge
Mental state
surprise for
as
me. Whatever mental state you are in right now.
wow, okay.
So I didn't really expect that you would be. So that was a huge surprise for me, a very pleasant surprise.
Nice. I'm happy to surprise you. Sonia's birthday and marriage anniversary date.
Day,
In
day.
5 seconds,
20.
I said rapid fire, bro.
22nd September.
Yeah, and
and
marriage anniversary.
Day. Funnada.
Come on, come on, be fast.
5th December. Shit. I hope that's right.
Sonia, is it correct? Wait, I'm sure she'll reply.
Dude, it became tight, dude. We were talking only about tennis. Yeah, that's right answer. Wife
No,
is laughing,
I'm
so
saying
it's
it's fourth.
fourth. So fourth night we celebrate. Midnight we celebrate. So.
What time is it? 11:30 p.m. means it's fourth only. It's not fifth. All right, good save. So the next 5 questions. One piece of advice you would give Prajnesh right now.
Prajnesh.
Yeah.
I mean, I would love to. One piece of advice I would give Prajnesh right now is I would love to see him get like super, super fit.
Okay, nice.
Top 50 fit,
One,
yeah.
if you could go back in time, one thing you would change in your life, apart from the marriage. No, I'm just kidding.
One thing I would change. I mean, it's. I don't know. I think the way I handled my injury in 2013.
Away, Arjun Kare has a rapid fire for you. One advice Sonia could give to Vishnu right now at this point of his life.
Right Sonia, now, I am sitting in the bedroom. I am sitting in the bedroom. Sonia is out. I am not getting out of the bedroom. I am trying to open this window and jump from here and run.
Cut that one, Arjun. Okay. If not for Siddharth, your son's name, what was your next favorite name? What was your second option?
My second option? I was very sure with this name. I mean, I love this name.
Yeah, but other than that, did you have anything in mind? Or what?
I mean, if it was a daughter, then we were thinking about the name Vani for a daughter. So
Vani?
Yeah, okay. That's the, Vani. We were just playing around with that name, yeah.
Alright, what age, according to you, I should marry?
According to you, I don't think there's a perfect age, bro, to get married.
No, I mean,
when the time is right.
If you could give me a number, what age?
If I would give you a number, I normally think, you know, between 30 to 33, 35 is a good age to get married.
It?
In general. In general, I think that's a good number. You just ask for a number. Okay. But apart from that, I don't think there's a right time. You know, you just, if you feel it right, it's right. That's it.
Okay, and last question for the day. If Mukund gave you the responsibility of doing an arranged marriage to you, to give you, which is a high chance that you choose a wife for him, what is the three qualities you would look in a girl?
Three qualities?
For him, as you know me. I know it's a very kind of funny rapid fire. There's no kill, marry, hook up and all that.
That's a good question, dude. Why not? It's a good question. Three qualities. She should cook really good.
Or even one main quality that you would look for. As
one
you know,
main quality? She should cook really good, dude. Or like Abhinav says, you know, she should cook really good, she should wash clothes and she should drive the car well.
that's actually not bad, because I mean, I'm a foodie and I can't drive a car. So
exactly. Yeah, I mean, and it's always great when you come back home like exhausted and tired and you have something smelling nice, you know. I mean, it happens sometimes. When I'm coming home, you know, I come home and then there's
a
fresh baked cake.
Sonia is not a good cook. Is that true, Sonia?
No, I'm saying she's a good cook, dude. That's why I'm saying I'm having good experience over here at home. So, yeah, I hope you have the same thing.
Nice. Okay. This or that, okay? Last 2 minutes.
Okay, cool.
If Sidhu could win a Filmfare or he could be top 20 in tennis, what would you choose?
Filmfare.
If Sidhu could be a playboy or happily married.
Happily married.
Give me the right answer.
happily married, dude. Or maybe playboy first and then be happily married.
No, playboy first.
Happily married, dude.
Oh, nice. Okay. Vishnu, you have been absolutely phenomenal. Thank you. The rapid fire was just a fun thing. It was never in the plan.
Oh, cool, dude.
But I think the wife was the best thing. Cook, and I remember Abhinav Sanjeev's revelation in China. That was, I mean, I remember you guys were roasting him, and thankfully, Sonia was there and Sri Lakshmi was not, I think. I think if Lakshmi was there, it would have been a different dinner altogether.
Alright, just stay here. Someone's come to say hi.
Oh my God. Hello, Mr. Siddharth.
Hi, Sulit. Sidhu. Hi.
Hello. Hi. When is he coming on my show?
He's always ready, dude.
Do you have any questions for me or should we end the session?
I actually have like a serious question, dude, for you.
Yes.
Just only one question. Okay, this is like on a very serious note, okay? And I've never asked you this. And so I know that you've worked with so many different coaches, you know, over the past. And the
Yeah.
connect what you're having right now with Martin, it's very
Yeah.
special. I have seen that on tour. So how, for anyone who is out there, who is trying to find that connect with a coach,
Yeah.
what do they have to do to find that? You know, how do you actually try to find that connect to a coach?
See, it would be wrong to say if that choice came from me, I think, because the first revelation I have to make is that Martin said this one day very clearly, because he said that you were just playing a set, and something from the sky, it told me that boom, this is your guy, just take him.
Wow.
He said that there was divine intervention in this. That I'm not kidding right now. This is exactly what he said. That I
Oh,
heard
wow.
my dead parents or someone from up there, they told me that this is your champion and take him and train him. So although you were fat, you were losing a practice set to somebody 700, but there is something spiritual or something, a voice from above. It told me that this is your player. Believe in him, trust him, nurture him. So, and even for me, I think, I just walked through the cafe in Bangkok where I said hello to him after meeting him. So I think this wouldn't have happened without some voice from the above. I know it's too good to be true, but that is one thing. But if I have to tell you a quality which will get you a good team in general, not just a coach, but a trainer, is to really identify the people who are trying to help you putting the ego aside, to listen to the words that they're trying, because even the listen to the words that they are saying without actually saying it, the voice that's coming without them putting it in words. So even though they are harsh, even though they are you have to keep your ego aside. That's one good thing I really did. I kept my ego completely aside and said, okay, this guy is trying to help me, so I gotta endure through it, because it was many, many tough moments in the beginning. He was not happy with the way I was behaving, with the way I was talking, and there were so many challenges. Because I remember, at the dinner table, he would say, I want you to talk and act like a superstar, like somebody like the Tamil actor Vijay. Whatever you talk, I want it to make sense. And I would be like, why? I just can't shut up. I just cannot. He said, no, I don't want you to shut up. I want you to talk, but stop when you have to stop, which is a very tough thing to do. Which means you have to judge the vibe in the dinner table. You have to know how to
That
put your.
exactly,
So
yeah.
he
And I
wanted
mean,
to me
it's,
to do
I
the
mean, you
best
can
for him.
easily, yeah, you can easily tell him that, you know, your job ends once you're out of the tennis court,
Exactly,
right?
exactly.
And
And
that's how
I
normally most of the
believe.
coaches are. They are very professional, that they don't really interfere, you know.
Yeah.
Their job is done when they're out of the tennis court. So and I feel it's important that the coach gets in little bit involved to develop that kind of character and personality that he wants to
And there
see
were
on the court.
so many tough things
So
that I had to start dressing different. I had to start walking
yeah,
different. I had
that
to
we've
start
all, yeah, we, yeah, that's
greeting
true. I've
people
experienced that,
differently.
yeah.
So all those things, I think a player has to put the ego aside. Even though you get many harsh comments after a match and you get really bad criticisms, you feel like quitting sometimes, but you really have to. Whether it's a parent or it's a friend or it's a coach, you have to see who is really trying to help you and who is trying to flatter you. And I think if you have this ability to see that in a person, the chances of you finding the right people in your life, not just a coach, but even when it comes to your wife or your friends or some decisions you listen to your parents, it will make life easier. But Martin, as I said, the first thing, if destiny would not play a role, we wouldn't be here today. I think something, because I can tell you two experiences in my life which started making me believe something is above all of us. Until then, I did not believe in God. Even today, I don't believe in naming a God. But I think the first experience was in 2008. My mom, in a taxi in Kolkata, we were playing a championship series under 16 or 14 or 16. She was telling me in the taxi that you started playing tennis in Kolkata. I did start playing tennis in Calcutta, and your sister, I got conceived here, And I have a very special connection with the Kali Mata temple there because I went and prayed and your father was facing a lot of problems officially in the office, you know. So it was a very tough phase for me and I found solace in the city. I found strength to hang on. And your most career special moment in tennis will come in Kolkata and I believe it. She said that.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, you must be freaking crazy out of your head. Which Grand Slam or Challenger or, you know, I don't know which ATP event is going to happen in Kolkata. And it's a shithole of a city. And, you know, I don't see a tour event happening here. And it's the most dirtiest city ever, I'm sorry to say. And all these things. And until 2019, January 29th, I did not believe it that a career-changing moment will come in Calcutta. But then, you know, I think 13 years later, the Indian flag was in front of me, the jacket was on me, and I was standing for the national anthem, first time in Davis Cup debut in Calcutta. So that's when I actually felt, how the hell did she know that 14 years back? So that is, one thing. That's one thing which makes me say, okay, there is something beyond science, I think. And Martin and my connection is something similar to that.
That's great, man. That's nice. No, yeah, even I believe that let it be any relationship, you know, let it be with your better half, your coach, your trainer, your parents and all. There has to be, you know, something which it's beyond, you know, that you can comprehend and you can understand. But yeah, I think a good point is to put your ego aside to make a good team for yourself, because I feel now we are in an age and in a time where I see a lot of players switching coaches very frequently. And it's okay if you want to try out with a different coach, but I feel it's important that they try to find that kind of a connect, what me, I'm having with my coach, or you are having right now with Martin, and, you know, many other players. Let it be all the top players, also, they have this connect, and that's the one of the main reasons that they're able to maximize their potential. So, yeah, that's about it, bro.
Yeah, super. Thanks, Na. Thank you for coming.
No problem,
man.
No problem. Yeah.
And you out
happy to be here,
questions.
Yeah.
Questions, you know, you just asked, this is what I meant by enlightenment. I asked 5 questions, you asked 1 question, but the show is ahead because of the 1 question.
Yeah, right.
So, yeah, maybe it's time to a marriage for me also, no? If it's giving that much change in me, then I don't mind marrying twice. Honestly.
The next Master Chef, my India Master Chef is your wife.
So then I think, then wait for me to crack top 100 and then you guys can start the hunt for the chef.
Yeah, sure. For now, hunt is on for Bala.
Bala, we don't need a master chef. We need a Konar Kadai Madurai mess chef. That's the food that he likes. The paratha and curry varwal, all that.
All right, bro.
Thank you.
Got to go then, yeah. See you, man. Bye.
All right, guys. That was Vishnu Vardhan. I think it was a fantastic chat. These live sessions are only getting better and better thanks to the people who agreed to spend their time for me. Thank you to all of you. Pratik, should we look for someone for you, Mukund? Oh, yeah, Pratik, please. One of those. Why not? If it's giving you so much yarn and a guy starts talking less, then I would, it's probably the right move for me, I think, at the moment. And thanks, guys. It was great as usual. And see you again soon with another guest.